Good afternoon, all of you. I welcome all of you to this webinar on non-pesticide management being organized by Center for Sustainable Agriculture and Grameen Academy. Grameen Academy is an initiative by Center for Sustainable Agriculture, a premier independent institution working on agriculture and rural livelihoods. And the main objective of Grameen Academy is to create an alternative learning ecosystem to build knowledge and skills and attitudes of the rural youth, rural women, and others. For this to happen, we strongly believe that building knowledge and skills is important to establish efficient and effective institutional platforms. So Grameen Academy offers several on-campus, on-field, and online courses. And this is one of the first of these initiatives. And today, coming to the subject, non-pesticide management, we all know high usage of pesticides in agriculture is a huge problem, and excessive use of pesticides in extensive monocultures of crops and varieties has disturbed the ecological balance, and it's leading to pest outbreaks. Selection of pressure leads to resurgence and resistance among insects, and this high usage of pesticides, we all know, is hazardous to it's not only entering our food chain, it's also polluting the soil, water, environment, and also causing huge health problems in human beings and also animals. Pesticides can be managed without chemicals. So the concept of non-pesticide management is basically this. And we called it NPM. So NPM is an approach where farmers can manage pests without using chemicals. And this concept has evolved over past maybe 15 years. In Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, this has been in practice since 2005. And it has really evolved from the experiences, from the issues faced, from lessons learned, and from constraints. It has been widely accepted by academicians and development organizations and in ecological approaches also. But here, there is a huge gap. At the field level, there is no information readily available to the farmers when a pest breaks out, how to do, how to manage pests, and what tools to use. This objective of this webinar is to fill this gap, basically. So we have two speakers today, Dr. G.V. Ramanjaneyalu, who is an agriculture extension scientist, and he's also executive director of Center for Sustainable Agriculture. And we also have Dr. G. Chandrasekhar, who is also with Center for Sustainable Agriculture, and he heads Grameen Academy. His specialization is in pests and disease. So the first two speakers will present, and after that, we'll have a question and answers. So first, I invite Dr. G.V. Ramanjaneyalu to speak about the concept of NPM and its applications and all. Ram, please. Dr. Ramu, please.
Good evening, all. And thanks, Asha, for the introduction. We are in a year of International Year of Plant Health. And when the world is going through a fundamental health crisis, now there is a recognition that the planetary health depends on the plant health. The plants are not healthy, and if your food is not healthy, the planet will not be healthy. And much of the deaths we are seeing, much of the crisis we are seeing, is all because of the way pests, the crops are handled, and then food becoming unsafe for consumption. And one of the main reasons for this is the pesticides, chemical pesticides, which are creating the problem. So I'm very excited to discuss about this initiative, about how we can manage crops without using chemical pesticides, and what are the learnings we had over the last 20, 25 years. In fact, see, our parent organization, CWS, started working on this concept 30 years back. The first conference on managing pests without using pesticides was done in 1989. So it's almost 30 years, and we are trying to understand how pests can be managed in an agro ecosystem. That's our whole idea. And when we are doing that, one of the major realization is, what is damaging us? Is it pests or pesticides? You look at actually looks and all the learnings and experiences shows, we are actually more damaged by the pesticides than the pest itself. And why this is happening? Because the chemical pesticides, they disturb the ecological balance. And once the ecological balance gets disturbed, the pest damage gets more. And then the pest damage, as the pest damage increases, you get to spray more. And then once you are spraying more, then you get into a vicious trap of pesticides. You spray more and more, pests develop resistance, and then finally you end up without managing the pest, but killing yourself with the pesticides. That's exactly what is happening around us. So why this is happening? So if you understand from that point of view, the pests and diseases are the symptoms of underlying ecological disruption. That's a fundamental scientific understanding we need to have. So what we see as pest and disease is a symptom of underlying ecological distortion. What is this ecological distortion and how it is caused? If you look at it, is a reducing biodiversity. So extensive monoculture of crops and extensive monoculture of varieties within the crop. Say today, cotton, rice, soya, sugarcane occupies about 60% of the cropped area in the country. In states like Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, there are one or two crops which occupy about 60-70% of the cropped area. Telangana, it's rice and cotton, which occupies near about 70% of the area. And Madhya Pradesh, 60% of the area is under soybean. And Andhra Pradesh, rice and groundnut occupies about 60% of the cropped area. So we are getting into wide monoculture of crops. Within the crop also, we are reducing the diversity. Say rice, for example, across the country, if near about 50 to 60% of the cultivated area is under rice, near about 85% of it comes from varieties which have a same background. 85% of the area has the same background, the TN1 background, which came in from IRRI. So if that's a kind of extensive monoculture we are getting into, pest problem are going to increase. Why and all, let's see. Second is about the reducing soil health. So soil health is also getting disrupted. So we are, once the soil health goes, then obviously there is a chances of increasing pests, diseases, and weeds. Say the more salinity increases, more weeds grow. So that's a second important factor we need to think of. Third important factor is the high use of chemicals is disrupting the ecological balance by killing the natural enemies. So that's a third factor. Fourth factor is, the more pesticides we use, there is a selection pressure which is built in, and that selection pressure causes a resurgence and resistance. Resurgence and resistance is an important biological concept we need to understand. Say if there are 100 insects, and then if you are spraying pesticides, we are killing the weak insects. And then what is left over is the insects which could resist the pesticide which you have sprayed. Next time when you are spraying, you spray whatever is left over, and within that, if there are weak insects, they will die, and you are actually making a selection for the genetic resistance. Then what do? We spray another round of pesticide, which is much stronger or with more frequency. So second time when we spray, all other weak insects also go. So second time, third time, fourth time, when we do the same process, we'll be left with insects which are more stronger. That is one process which happens. Second, when there is a high use of chemicals and all insects are dying, by a natural selection process, insects start developing resurgence. So they tend to evolve resistance. They tend to grow stronger. Second, what happens is insects which are not stronger till then suddenly becomes strong insects. Say, for example, pink bollworm was not a serious problem till, say, 2012. After 2012, pink bollworm in cotton has become a serious problem. Similarly, mealybug was not such a serious problem in cotton, but after 2008, it has become a serious problem. So that is something which happens. Another important issue is about the favorable conditions, say more moisture and all those kind of situations may also lead to increase in the pests and diseases. Another important thing which is not in the hands of the people. See, all these factors are because of the way we are doing agriculture. There is a one more factor which is not in our hands. It is the climate change. Because of the climate change, we are also seeing changes in the pest and disease dynamics. And if this is the problem, managing them by using more of pesticides is not a solution. So we need to move towards an alternative framework. And that alternative framework is the shift from replacing one molecule with another. Say if endosulfan doesn't work, we replace with monocrotophos. If monocrotophos doesn't work, we replace with synthetic pyrethroids. If synthetic pyrethroid doesn't work, we'll replace it with imidacloprid. So these kind of replacing one molecule with another is not a solution. We need to move away from practices to a management system. How do we manage it? How do we prevent a problem than controlling the problem? We need to move towards ecological engineering or non-pesticidal management. So there are various approaches towards that. How do we make a shift is something which is very, very important. We need to look into. So one step back, if we take and then look into it, one of the key fact we all need to understand is in this world, 75% of the living beings are insects. So if you put plants, microorganisms, birds, all these together, it's about 75% are only insects. And the life of an insect is about 2 months, maximum is about 2 months. So if an insect life cycle is about just 2 months or less than 6 weeks, if that is the life cycle, and each time if it can put in about 500x or 1000x kind of thing, and if they are 75% of the insects, living beings are insects, and they are living on this planet for more than 30 crore years. And say human beings are only living on this earth for 10 lakh a year. So if you put all these things together, world would have been full of insects by now, isn't it? Every insect, if they are multiplying by 500 times every time in 4 months, if every insect multiplies by 500 times over 30 crore years, how many insects would have been there? It is not the case. Why? That's because there is a natural balance which is happening in the environment. Also, there is an ingenuity of the farmers in terms of evolving cropping patterns, which can solve the problem and keep the pests under control. Unfortunately, in the last 70, 80 years, we tend to get into a monoculture of crops and then managing pests by spraying high toxic chemical pesticides. So that actually distorted the ecological balance. So that's a point we need to remember. So what do we do? I think one of the key approach is about the non-pesticidal management. This is Asha has already mentioned, is a set of practices which evolved from the ground experiences in Andhra Pradesh. And this was done on fairly on a large scale also. So whenever we talk about alternatives, people say this is done in by 10 farmers or one village or two villages. So it is not possible kind of thing. In Andhra Pradesh, this was tried out with 35 lakh acres. And data shows that between 2004 and 2010, over 50% of the chemical pesticide use in Andhra Pradesh has come down. Compared to any other state, this is the highest reduction. You can actually go to any of the data available today by Government of India on the pesticide use, and Andhra Pradesh records the lowest. Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, these two states, records the lowest per hectare pesticide use. And you can clearly see a downward trend, which you don't observe in any other state. I think that's a very clear indication that something is happening here. So what is that happening? It is about a shift towards a management system called non-pesticidal management, which involves an integrated approach to prevent insects from reaching the damaging stage. Say in a life cycle of an insect, say, like I was saying, if an insect lives for about 2 months, in that less than a month is what it can damage. Rest of the days, it is in the egg stage, larval stage, pupal stage, where it won't damage the crop. But we also don't identify it in that stage of the insect. So if you can identify the insect at that stage, it is easy to manage. This is one of the fundamental principles. Second is, can we create an ecosystem where pest multiplication goes down? We will take some examples and explain how that works. Second, can we use traps? Can we use every insect as an attraction towards light? Every insect as an attraction towards color? Every insect as an attract towards smell? So how do we use these as a traps so that you can attract the insects and then either divert them or kill them? So that is the second. And once the insect population is kept under control, managing them becomes much easier. So if you have a excessive insects in front of you, controlling them may become very difficult. If the insect population is low, managing them becomes easier. So preventive control is something which is very, very important. So that's a fundamental concept on which non-pesticidal management is built on. So the minimal pest damage is based on reducing the pest numbers and growing healthy plants. How do we reduce pest numbers? It can reduce it by habitat conversion in terms of cropping patterns. We can reduce it by increasing the beneficial organisms in this ecosystem. We can also use reactive inputs to manage it. Say we can spray some of the botanicals or microbial products so that we can manage it. Second, grow healthy plants in terms of build healthy soils and then grow healthy plants and reduce the stress on the crop. Say more use of nitrogenous fertilizers leads to enhancement increase in the brown plant hopper in rice. So if you don't reduce the nitrogenous fertilizer use in rice, whatever you do, it may not help the managing the brown plant hopper. Similarly, if the plants are grown very closely, brown plant hopper multiplication becomes easier because there is a lot of darkness at the bottom of the field. So can we change the way crops are grow, the cropping pattern happens, and then the agronomy of crops can be changed, and also in terms of nutrient application can change so that the population of pests can come down. Then we can go and adopt the practices in terms of controlling them. That's a key principle of that. And whenever we talk about this, the insect literacy becomes very important. So if you can identify the insect, if you can identify the pest, then you can manage it well. Say, if you don't know what is your problem, how do you solve your problem? What is happening largely is you don't identify the problem. So we recommend farmers to get into a scheduled sprays. So in the scheduled sprays, what do? Is 10th day you spray this, 15th day you spray this, 20th day you spray this kind of approach is what we are taking, rather than actually identifying the problem and managing it. And all insects are not same. So insects are very, very different. So if you identify the insects based on their behavior, we can manage it easier. Say for example, sucking pests. All sucking pests, they basically suck juices and they transmit diseases as vectors. So the problem is about, on one hand, if they suck the juice, plant gets shrinked and then the plant leaves become distorted and then they may die. Second, they also transmit vectors like mosquitoes transmit malaria. All these insects also transmit a lot of diseases. Say, thrips transfer diseases, aphids transfer diseases, all these transfer diseases. So when they transfer diseases, plants gets affected. So how do we prevent them is one part we need to look at. How sucking pests can be managed. Second group of the pests are the chewing and biting type, which you see as a borer. So paddy stem borer, root grubs, fall armyworm, which is majorly seen in maize, brinjal fruit shoot borer. So all these are the second group of pests which we need to manage. So in these two kinds of insects also. So basically, if you go by the behavior and the body nature, if you understand that, there are soft-bodied insects, there are hard-bodied insects, there are insects which are eating stem, there are insects which are eating root. So if this can be understood, it can be easily be managed. That's a point we need to understand. And if I am saying we need to identify insect, we need to understand the insects, it may look very big, say there will be thousands and millions. When I said there are 75% of the human, the population, the living beings are insects, then you may think there are a number of insects. How do I identify, how farmers can identify kind of thing. But in terms of damaging insects, there are not too many. It's much easier to identify. Say some of the examples are kept here. So by seeing them, you can identify them very easily, not very difficult. And we actually pulled out all insects together, and it's about 15 or 16 groups of insects which are damaging the crops. So if you can identify these things, it's much easier. So how do we train farmers in identifying pests is a very important step towards managing insects. Many of us end up actually learning how to make a neem kashayam is a pest management. No, learning to make neem kashayam is a skill. That's all. What pest you have, how do you identify that, how do you manage it is something which is very, very critical. And so here, I'm not getting into the details, but another colleague of mine will be explaining about all this. So please don't think in terms of, there is too much to learn. It is actually much simpler one. You just need to go through some insects which are damaging the crops. Second very important issue here is in all these insects, say if I am saying 15 group, a group of 15 groups of insects are damaging, all may not be affecting your crops. So if you are growing 5 crops, there could be about 15-20 insects which are damaging. So focus on them, learn about them, it is much easier. I think that is a key point I'm trying to say. And there is a good learning which is already available in terms of which is the damaging stage, how many days it will damage, so how do we identify it, and then how do we prevent it from growing. So all these learnings are already available, and then that's a point, that's what my colleague will talk about.